Hello and welcome to livealittlehigher.com. Today we will finish our learning on the mystery of marriage by Rabbi Itzhak Ginsberg. It's been a little more than a year that we started learning this book, this holy book, which gives us an insight into what marriage really means in a mystical way, in a very tactical, human way. I suggest that if you haven't seen them all, you can go always to www.livealittlehigher.com, and in the classes you will find all the classes of the mystery of marriage since chapter one. And today we will finish talking about conception. Last week we were talking about how conception, when a couple unites in marital intimacy, it has to be in the most modest way and most holy way, because when we're creating life, we're really drawing down a soul and we're giving a person a life, and everything we do and we think and the way we behave while we're having our relationship with our spouse affects the baby. So we have learned before how the kavanah, the intent during the marital relationships, influences the nature of the child. As we know, what the father is thinking, his feelings, are what's going to shape the garments of the soul of this baby. The garments of the soul are the thought, the speech, and the action. And this is the way a person behaves in this world. It doesn't mean that a person will behave like this all their life. That's why Hashem gave us a guide. He gave us the Torah to refine us and to teach us what is right, what is not proper. But the more you help that baby come into this world in a holy way, the less of a struggle he's gonna have having to deal with the way he thinks, the way he speaks, and the way he talks. So the also in addition, the modest behavior is a prerequisite to drawing down a holy soul. So depending on the way that the couple behaves at that moment, they're gonna draw down a soul, and depending on their kavanah, their intention, this soul will come from a very high place or it will come from a not so high place. So giving birth to a child really means giving birth to one true self, because that child that is going to come into this world is going to be shaped by how you think, how you speak, how you act, how you behave. And we get very upset at our kids because they act like this, they say this, they don't do this. But in reality, they are an expression of our thoughts and our feelings in the times of the conception. I always tell people, be the person you want your kids to be. Parents are always educating the kids to be something, but usually the parent is not like that. And it's not fair to ask a child to be a certain, to live in a certain way if the same parent is not living up to that way. So be the person you want your children to be. Remember this. And a woman, there's the story of a woman. Her name was Kim Chit, and she had seven sons. And they all served as high priest, as the Kohen Gadol, in the times of the Holy Temple. And one day the sages asked her, how was it that she merited having these very holy children? Imagine, seven children, they were all holy. And she says that not even the walls, the beams of her house, had ever seen her. Like, she had never exposed her hair or her body to the walls of her home. And the sages applied the saying, this verse that is we read in Tehillim, the glory of a princess is within. So the glory of a woman really is inside of her. And so getting married and having children is similar to the mystery of unraveling the secrets of the Torah. And this is why one shouldn't learn Kabbalah before you're married. Some rabbis say, actually, you should not learn Kabbalah until you're 40 years old, because we're not mature enough to learn Kabbalah. What I'm teaching you is really not Kabbalah. It's practical Kabbalah. It's mysticism, which is applied to your daily life. But the deep, deep core Kabbalah should not be learned until you're 40 years old, because we're not ready to take this knowledge. So this is what they say. So before marriage, a person should devote to learn Halacha and all the revealed part of the Torah. Halacha really is what teaches a Jew how to act, how he should behave. The Gemara teaches a Jew how he should think. And these two things we should learn while we are not married, because the way you think is the way you're gonna behave eventually. Sometimes you have to fake it till you make it. It should be the other way around. But nevertheless, before marriage, we should try to really refine ourselves before we enter a relationship, because we're gonna bring all our dirty dishes with us into the relationship, and then it makes it a harder, it makes it a struggle to be able to perfect the marriage. So once we're married, we should begin the pursuit of a livelihood, of earning a living. And what it means here is that we should make the mundane a dwelling place for Hashem. So where is it the most mundane place in the world? Is the home. Dirty dishes, dirty house, dirty children, a husband that comes home and he's tired, and the wife is tired, and she still has to iron the shirts for him to put tomorrow. This is a place where it's the most mundane place in your life. It's gonna be your home. So, and here is where we have to strive to have marital harmony. And when we have marital harmony, what we're doing is that we're really bringing Shalom Bayit into our home, and we're really making our life a place where Hashem can dwell with us. So by studying the inner dimensions of the Torah, one develops one's sensitivity to the mystery of holiness, of life, and by relating to each other with modesty and tapping into each other's soul, it taps us into each other's soul root, as we talked at the beginning of this class, that we should never forget that the couple really is one soul divided in two in this world, and that the root of our soul is the same root as the soul of our husband. We should never forget this. And dedicating our lives to fulfilling Hashem's will. So when a couple lives their lives in this way, in which they make the ordinary extraordinary, they make their life a dwelling place for Hashem, everything they do with respect and with love and modesty and tolerance and admiration one for the other, appreciation one for the other, then we are living with God's will. We're doing what He intended at the beginning. So this is the essence of the mystery of marriage. It sounds funny because we think it's something very mysterious, but the reality is that it's very common. It's what it is. It's life. And life is mysterious. But when we make it modest and we make it proper, then we'll always live with that sense of mystery and of awe, and refreshing a view of our marriage will come to us. So it was a pleasure for me, it was an honor to be able to teach you this book by Rabbi Itzhak Ginsberg. If you want to read it, you can go to Amazon.com, I think they have it there, or you can find it in any Judaica store. It's a jewel, it's worth having it. And now that you know all these concepts, these mystical concepts, it will be easier for you to understand. So I wish you a great week, and remember, live a little higher. Thank you.